pick all collaborationists, at least dealing with composing and writing of lyrics, create a marriage between words and music. But you and Oscar seem to emphasize a marriage between the somatic intent with the musical expression. You started it actually in Oklahoma, but I think you continued it in State Fair, particularly with It Might As Well Be Spring. I'm thinking of the musical phrase you wrote to accommodate three separate lines. Do you remember here in particular where she sings, "I'm as jumpy as a puppet on a string"?
Oh, yeah, sure. Well, this part of it is something you could even call carpentry.
Carpentry?
Yeah. Or plumbing.
Yes.
You know, or changing a tire. This is something you should be able to do. If the man says, "I'm as jumpy as a puppet on a string," it shouldn't be very difficult to make your tune go dum da dum da dum da dum da dum da dum.
Well, it gives it the impression of jumpiness.
That's all.
And a slight uneasiness with that last note.
That's right. And it's unresolved. And of course, at this point in the play, which happened to be a picture.
Yes.
The girl was very unresolved in her own mind. All she knew is that she wanted to be in love and didn't even have a fellow to be in love with. So you have an unresolved chord to end up your phrase. But this is the interesting thing, Arnold, that in writing these things, you don't go through the thought process that I've just gone through for you.
What process do you go through?
It's there.
Well, how do you mean it's there? That's interesting.
Well, you look at the words. I'm as jumpy as a puppet on a string. And you know your music has to be jumpy. You know your girl. And you love her. Never laid eyes on her because she doesn't exist. But you're full of sympathy for her. And you write the end of your phrase that is troubled the way you know she is.
Then there were two other phrases in the same song, like a nightingale without a song to sing. Didn't you have the same music to that?
Yes, and this is a technical situation that you find yourself in. I couldn't change the music for that phrase because in the lyrical construction, it balanced the first phrase about the puppet.
Yes.
So the music had to be the same. But there are other phrases in the same song where this attack...
Well, yeah, she says, "I'm as giddy as a baby on a swing,"
giddy
which is
as a baby on a swing. Well,
same.
It's the same thing,
yes,
as the puppet. And you you state it in the same way musically.
Well, then when she sang "like a nightingale without a song to sing," which obviously doesn't imply the same jumpy quality that the other two phrases contain in themselves, then you're counting on the power of semantics to make the bridge.
Also, I'm counting on the power of the girl who's going to sing the song. I am counting on the fact that she will know enough to sing this smoothly.
Mm-hmm.
And possibly a little sadly, "The Nightingale Without a Song."
Yes.
And sure enough, that's the way it was done.
So it's an interpretive marriage to the semantics of the lyric and the construction of the melodic line.
That's right. Now, you get all kinds of marriages in a situation like this. The marriage of the fellow who orchestrates it. The marriage with the conductor, who has to know. With the cameraman, who has to know how to photograph the girl at this particular point, sitting in the window seat, looking out over the farm. Everybody has to get married. This is what I've said to you before, that the whole business is the most intense collaborative effort in the world, with the possible exception of running a war. Everybody has to fit with everybody else.
I'm as restless as a willow in a windstorm. I'm as jumpy as a puppet on a string. I'd say that I had spring fever, but I know it isn't spring. I'm starry-eyed and vaguely discontented, like a nightingale without a song to sing. Oh, why should I have spring fever when it isn't even spring? I keep wishing a spider spinning daydreams. I'm as giddy as a baby on a swing. I haven't seen a crocus or a rosebud, so I know
you also transferred the same idea, not transferred it because this preceded the State Fair in Oklahoma, when you wrote the music for Chicks and Ducks and Geese Better Scurry.
Yeah, but this doesn't fulfill itself until you've finished the line. When I take you home in the Surrey, or when we go out, which is it? The phrase, Dan?
When I take you home...
When I take you out in the sun.
Yes.
The whole idea of the road being flat, mm-hmm. and the horse and buggy going along the flat road, you try to say this musically. So you start flat. Bum, 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 bum. Bum, 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 bum.
Chicks and ducks and geese better scurry when I take you out in the Surrey. When I take you out in the Surrey with the fringe on top. Watch that fringe and see how it flutters when I drive them high-stepping strutters. Nosy pokes will peek through the shutters and their eyes will pop. The wheels are yellow, the upholstery's brown, the dashboard's genuine leather. With eyes and glass curtains, you can roll right down in case there's a change in the weather. Two bright side lights winking and blinking, ain't no finer rig I'm a-thinking. You can keep your rig if you're thinking that I'd care to swap for that shiny little Surrey with the fringe on the top.
This is only interpretation, and this happens in every art, in every expression. You interpret.
Well, now I'm thinking again of the interpretive quality you gave to the music surrounding Bloody Mary in South Pacific. The Bally High flavor with which you surrounded her.
This is my work.
No, but I'm furthering this thought of Oscar's and yours, of the marriage between the semantics and the musical expression.
That's right. This exists. This is constant. This is everything you do.
Now, how much do you miss the power of the word when you begin to let instrumentation, if not orchestration, speak for some of your characters as you did in The King and I? If I remember correctly, the king and his interpreter were both silent, and you let a bassoon or a clarinet
That's right,
both. Extend their
because
thought.
They were talking Siamese.
Yes.
And the audience couldn't understand the language. So I put it in the orchestra pit.
Yes.
And let these two instruments talk for the characters on the stage. And they simply gestured on the stage. And something that you and I know very well, music being the only universal language we have, this is very simple. The audience always knew what they were saying.
Pardon me, the audience then superimposed its own thought.
This is where...
With your suggestion of music.
Where we, who work with music, have a better break than anybody else.
Well, that's from your point of view. Oscar, who worked with words, said that because practically everybody wrote words, that lyrics were much easier, because so few people composed music, that music represented the great mystery. So apparently this is a matter of perspective, on which side of the fence you sit.
I think music is a mystery to most people. And I think largely because it's the one abstract art we have. You can listen to music and make your own interpretation. Of course, the minute you start putting it in conjunction with words, then you've become specific. It can only mean one thing. It can mean the Surrey with the fringe on top. Or it can mean this little girl singing It Might As Well Be Spring. Then you become objective instead of subjective.
Now, you just used the word art a moment ago, Dick, and I'd like to discuss a line of your own which you said to me some time ago about art, that you defined it as the expression of an emotion by means of a technique. Since you first began writing with Larry way back in 1919 or 1918, what really significant changes have you seen within the context of this expression of art in the musical theater up to the present?
It's been fantastic. Until Showboat, nobody dared deal with essentials in the musical theater.
Now, by essentials, what do you mean? You're relating it essentially to story.
Yes, story, content, musical content, lyric content, every kind of essential. Nobody would have dreamed of going near it. That happened in 1927.
with Chubba.
Chubba. From there on, the whole field took enormous strides in dealing with subject matters that had never been touched before.
There's an old man on the Mississippi. That's the old man that I'd like to be. Run the sea there if the world's got trouble. Run the sea there if the land is free. Old man river, yeah, old man river, he must know something, but no.
Dick, this was actually a gradual progression going way back. I wouldn't know how far back, to the days of music halls, where all you had were variety act presentations. Mustn't that be considered the genesis of the evolution of what we call a musical comedy, musical play?
Yes, but you're talking about the dramatic shift.
Oh, yes.
The change in approach. And this didn't come until much later. Larry and I tried, and in some ways succeeded. You know, we talked about Peggy Ann.
Yes.
Because this is Freudian. In the days when most people had never heard of Freud.
And might have served as a forerunner to Lady in the Dark and plays.
Well,
in
the way it
time.
Did.
Yes.
Morse's play was much more serious than Peggy Ann. Peggy Ann was done for fun, just for comedy. The Freudian dream for laughs. Mm-hmm. And Morse is very serious about that couch.
Yes.
Very. But Morse couldn't have been serious with his subject matter if John O'Hara hadn't been serious with Pal Joey. You see, all these things progress. One feeds the other. And now, you can say anything in the musical theater that you wanted.
Well, now, how do you make the distinction, then, according to that line, between the musical comedy and the musical play?
I don't make any distinction. I don't know what a comedy is. Comedy is something that has some laughs in it.
Well, do you think on that basis that everything you and Oscar have done together is a musical comedy?
In that sense, yes. Almost, well, literally all of them had laughs. But some of them were very seriously based, as you know.
Well, of course, as we discussed before, the problem of message, or the problem of a theme that you feel strongly about, which is serious.
Yeah, but not message.
All right, I'll retract the word message, at least from the standpoint of your intent. That wasn't your intent.
You know the
in
joke about
case.
The message?
No.
Very old theater joke. If you want to deliver a message, call Western Union. This has been around for years, and I still feel that way.
No, but the seriousness of a theme, Dick, through the medium of the motion of the musical comedy stage has really become sharper and sharper defined in the past 15 or 20 years.
Oh, yes.
Whereas you say today you can talk about anything.
Well, I would like to see you as the author of a musical comedy go up to Flo Ziegfeld and say, I got a great idea, Mr. Ziegfeld, for a musical show. And he says, what, Arnold? And you say, juvenile delinquency and kids murdering each other. Mr. Ziegfeld throws you right out of the window. Now, this is the man that I did a couple of shows for, who understood the female body very well. And he was great. He had a wonderful eye. But if you had said this to him, he literally would have thrown you through the window. Now, many years later, a show opens at the Winter Garden, which is about juvenile delinquency and kids killing each other. And it's a smash hit. It goes to London, it's a smash hit. They are making a moving picture of it now. This is how far we've progressed.
And the musical theater, musical comedy theater, if you will, has more and more become not just a means of entertainment as such, but also something of a mirror of our times.
Well, this can still be entertainment and entertaining.
Yeah, but the two are not mutually exclusive necessarily.
No, of course not. You can go to see very, very touching, deep plays and get awfully upset and walk out into 45th Street feeling purged.
Well, now,
you feel great because you've been emotionally relieved. You've seen something in the theater that has done something for you. And this is what I think theater should be.
But, Dick, when you say now that in the musical theater you can say anything you please, there's really no stop or no taboo on subject matter. If that's true, and I'm inclined to agree with you, where do you see the musical theater going in the future? Merely an extension of what it is now, or a continuation?
My guess would be that it would be an extension and a continuation. And there might be new elements that we don't even know today.
That's what I was concerned with, particularly our phrase of pushing the walls back.
Well, that's what it is. You find in the summer theater now, we have theater in the round. This is a mechanical, physical extension of the theater as we know it, without the proscenium, with people sitting in back of the actors, and not just front facing. This is a physical thing that has now been pushed out.
Yes. Well, since you're a composer, basically, and your essential interest is in composition, the depiction of our times in musical terms, I know it's close to your heart and certainly close to your experience in both Victory at Sea and currently Churchill, which is a wholly different commodity to deal with, isn't it, from your collaborative efforts with Larry Hart and Oscar. I know Victory at Sea wasn't the first purely musical thing you wrote, but it was certainly the first epic, if you can call it that, job that you had to undertake. What were your feelings about it from the standpoint of concept when this thing was offered to you?
Well, I was sitting in this very spot when it was offered to me, and I was scared stiff. How would I come to believe that I had the equipment to tell the story of the Navy in the last war in terms of music? You must have tremendous belief in yourself, or conceit, or blindness, or be drunk.
Or all four.
And I told the man I would have to have 2 weeks to try and work up enough courage to tackle this thing. And 2 weeks later, after discussing it with my wife, discussing it with Oscar, discussing it with myself endlessly, I decided to take the chance. And I needn't have worried that much if I had only reminded myself of something that I've always known and still do. That if you give the public a melodic line that they understand, you're pretty safe.
Yes, but certainly covered with different appurtenances than you give a melodic line rooted solely to musical comedy or the musical theater.
No words, but you have pictures. You may not have the Surrey with the fringe on top, but you have a carrier with airplanes on top.
Yes.
And this is what you do. I wrote a contrapuntal theme for the carriers. And what I did was write a very simple, low-lying melody for the carrier. And the counterpoint
for the airplanes.
For the airplanes, the staccato and Shaw. Mm-hmm. And they work together.
Yes.
This is not very different from taking somebody's words and setting them to music. You're taking a mood, content again.
Yes. Dick, in Churchill, you not only had the broad scope to depict of the incidents surrounding Mr. Churchill, but you also had the problem of depicting a personality, namely Mr. Churchill himself, which you didn't have in Victory at Sea, which I think gives Churchill...
No, very little in Victory at Sea.
Which gives Churchill an added dimension. Now, these two things so far have pulled you into a different stream from musical comedy that you had been in for all of your life. What do you see now as the extension of both Victory at Sea and Churchill?
Exactly what we were talking about before when we talked about the extension of musical comedy content. It is possible to say something about Churchill as a man in musical terms that a large television public will presumably understand in terms of music. And this is what I tried to do. I've got a very determined, angry Churchill with a cigar standing up like that. And I had to say this musically. I've also got a very pathetic Churchill, worried to death. What's going to happen to England? You know, usually we don't think about Churchill as being worried, but there are shots of him where he was. There was Churchill in his country place. Very bucolic. You say something about Chartwell, where he lived. And that isn't too hard to do if you have any musical sensibility. Can't you say a farm without having words? That's all the extension is on.
Now, you knew Churchill personally. You had met him.
I met him once. I met him in Boston. When? When he came to this country, talked in Boston, and then went to Fulton.
Oh, yes, in 46, when he delivered the Iron Curtain speech. Oh, yes, yes.
So that must have been Annie Get Your Gun.
Yes.
When we were in Boston, producing that, we didn't write it. We produced it. And I've always known Bernard Baruch very well because he and my father were classmates in college. And I phoned up and said, Oscar and I would love to meet Mr. Churchill. And they said, be up here at 10 tomorrow morning. And we were. We had Dorothy Hammerstein with us. My Dorothy wasn't in Boston,
yeah,
so she missed it. But the three of us went up and we met him. And, he couldn't have been cuter. He was just wonderful. Very jolly.
Had it been helpful to you, do you think, in depicting aspects of his personality?
No.
Because you had met him?
Not at all.
You would have gotten enough just from reading about him and
enough
learning
about him? Knowing about him, reading about him, looking at pictures of him. I didn't have to shake hands with him to get his quality.
Yes. But in depicting the incidents surrounding Churchill, I'm thinking most particularly about the different nations, the different nationalities involved. How did you handle this problem musically, Dick?
Only in my own terms. Let me make this a little more clear. This question has been asked me many times about the King and I.
Yes, it would relate to the King and I and Oriental music and how.
Now let's say the King and I and leave Churchill for a moment. What do you do about getting Oriental sound into the St. James Theater? Well, all I can do is try to express these sounds with my musical palette, with what I have to work with. If I tried to recreate actual Siamese music, the whole audience would have been out in the street within 10 minutes.
Supposing you were writing for Siamese audiences, that would be different, wouldn't it?
First of all, it'd have to be a Siamese. And I may never make it. You've reversed it now. I'm not a Siamese. I'm an American. And if I want to try and paint a picture, it's too funny the way we keep going back to another medium to express this.
Yes.
If you're trying to paint a musical picture of Siam, you do it in your terms. Suppose, let us say, to go back to this analogy again, you sent Grant Wood to Japan, said, make some pictures of Tokyo. He would come back with pictures of Tokyo, you would recognize Tokyo, you would like it, and you would say, that's Grant Wood.
So this was Dick Rodgers interpreting Poland, Germany, France, etc.
That's all you can do. That's all you can do. Do it in your terms.